I represent the rent is too damn high party. People are working 8 hours a day and 40 hours a week, and some a third job. Women can't afford to take care of their children, feed their children breakfast, lunch, and dinner. My main job is to provide a roof over your head, food on the table, and money in your pocket. This is politics as usual, playing a silly game. It's not going to happen. The rent too damn high movement, the people I'm here to represent can't afford to pay their rent. They're being laid off right now as I speak. They can't eat breakfast, lunch, or dinner. Listen, someone's stomach, child's stomach just growled. Did you hear it? You gotta listen like me.
Okay.
Let's talk about the issue.
People can't afford to pay their rent. 30 seconds for you, sir.
Rent is too damn high. As a karate expert, I will not talk about anyone up here because our children can't afford to live anywhere. Nowhere. There's nowhere to go. Once again, why? You said it, the rent is too damn high.
That was the memorable Jimmy McMillan, standing for the rent is too damn high party in the 2010 New York mayoral elections. Although the mannerisms in which he expresses his one-issue party may be amusing, the issue of high rent is less so. Many of the factors which afflicted the Big Apple nearly a decade ago are still prevalent in many parts of the United States, especially so in Portland, Oregon. In fact, according to Rent Jungle's website, as of November 26, the average rent in Portland since January 2011 to October of this year has risen a total of 58%. So why is the rent too damn high, and why have house prices nearly doubled? To fully understand, it helps to think about microeconomic theory surrounding supply and demand. On the demand side, we have seen a significant increase in population. The US Census Bureau reporting that between 2010 and 2017, Portland saw a 10.7% increase in population. This growth has been fueled by a booming local economy led by the tech and apparel industries. On the supply side, although increasing prices are of course a massive incentive to build housing, there's been a significant time lag between supply meeting rising demand. Partly due to the nature of the housing market being slow to meet demand, but on the other hand, supply has been exacerbated by the fact that population and job growth has been fueled by high-income jobs. Thus, construction companies have focused on increasing supply of only the most profitable sector of the market, high-end housing, entrenching pre-existing inequality.
Due to the rising rates of housing in the past decade, many Oregonians have experienced the struggle to afford a place to live. In both renting and owning, we are seeing the symptoms of this crisis more and more as wages stagnate and affordability is less within reach. Some of these symptoms coincide with many causes to the housing crisis in Portland, those including homelessness, gentrification, declining home ownership, and more young adults living with parents longer. According to pdxmonthly.com, nearly 14,500 people were documented as homeless in 2018, about 12,000 in 2015. Whether they were documented as unsheltered or in temporary housing, this was a factor due to the average rent percentage increase of 13.9% back in August 2015. Which was an increase of 6% earlier that year. Despite the average steadily decreasing to 3.1% in July this year, the cost for a one-bedroom apartment is about $1,462, and a two-bedroom is about $1,721, according to rentjungle.com. In addition to high rental costs, Portland's minimum wage is only $12.50. So if you correlate this relationship of rent versus wages, this, among other factors, can affect the homeless population, as proved since 2015. Most would agree that Portland is an attractive place to live, despite its high cost of living. But gentrification has been a problem for many renters, including those of low income. The renewing or maintaining of old apartments or homes to make them adhere to safety or city ordinance regulations is just one factor that caused the average rent to increase, as explained earlier. This process pushed many of the neighborhoods where low-income families resided, struggling to pay the increased rent, to displacement, or for lack of a better word, eviction. In 2018, PortlandOregon.gov states that in eastern Portland, there was roughly 14,000 low-income renter households, and 97% of those were already in early to mid-stage gentrification. Most of the renters who couldn't afford the increase have been forced to look for cheaper options or become homeless. In 2012, OregonLive.com states that the median price for homes in the Portland area was about $207,500. According to the same source, the median price in 2018 rose to $418,000. Another symptom to which home sales seemed to slow down by 3.3%. More homeowners had spent more time looking to buy, as the supply of new homes since flatlined in 2012. But for renters, there has been a stall in waiting lists for affordable housing. A StreetRoots.org article in 2018 states that local and federal subsidiaries closed in 2016, leaving applicants with a wait time of 2 to 20 years through the Home Forward Housing Authority. Since this source of affordable housing closed, more than 16,000 people applied for housing. And one such person, Tina Drake, who was living in a homeless shelter and looking for a job, had said, quote, "Portland is being gentrified. It's a high-income city." Since 2016, Portland's minimum wage has only increased $3.25. With renting rates almost doubling in the past decade, the millennial generation has been struggling to pay rent. OregonLive.com says nearly 28% of Oregon millennials receive cash infusion every month, end quote. Rising rents and home prices in Oregon is getting more difficult for many Oregonians to afford housing on their own, end quote. According to WWeek.com, the failure to launch is also significantly reducing the demand for housing. They state the housing crisis will be a lot worse if 20 to 30-year-olds didn't live with their parents. Across this age group, there are generally 36,000 less households on demand. As they are at home longer, construction companies don't see any demand to construct new homes.
For so many, the high cost of housing is a painful reality, leaving so many people homeless. Most people living on lower income spend half of what they take home on shelter. Here are some of the current solutions and programs. Cascadia Clusters is a nonprofit organization training houseless Portlanders to build affordable, sustainable, transitional housing with a high-quality workforce. The Cascadia Clusters develop tiny homes and other small footprint structures for government, nonprofit, and private private use, as well as offer affordable residential and commercial construction services. Human Solutions is a nonprofit organization helping the homeless and the houseless. This group provides homeless and other services to people of the greater Portland area. Some of their resources include housing, utility assistance, and job training. Just as of last year, the individuals at Human Solutions have helped over 9,000 households avoid having their utilities shut off and remain warm and safe in their homes by providing utility assistance. Innovative Housing is a nonprofit that provides safe, high-quality, affordable housing to individuals and families, along with other services to help our residents maintain their housing, access opportunities, and break the cycle of poverty. Habitat for Humanity is a nonprofit organization that provides homes families with 35 to 60% of medium income. And they do this by providing mortgages with no down payment, mortgage payments that are no more than 30% of the homeowner's income. Habitat's vision is of a world where everyone has a decent place to live. Habitat for Humanity partners with the people in our community and all over the world to help them build or improve a place they can call home. Now, let's talk about the Portland Housing Bond. This is a voter-approved initiative to develop affordable housing. Using two different approaches, they create affordable homes. The first is to build multifamily rental housing in local neighborhoods with access to public transit and other valuable resources. The second approach is to buy existing buildings that get fixed into permanent affordable rental housing. Some other solutions could include capping overpriced rent and housing costs. Doing this by setting a maximum price that renters and homeowners can be charged. You can build smaller homes and limit or restrict areas from building multi-unit buildings like fourplex apartments and large homes. This would make the places affordable because you're limiting the size. Housing assistance includes Section 8. Section 8 is one of the largest and oldest government programs aimed at helping people find affordable housing. HUD is public housing. This government program was established to provide decent and safe rental housing for eligible low-income families, the elderly, and the people with disabilities. There's privately owned subsidized housing. This helps to find and place people in low-income housing. We can also invest in old vacant boarded-up buildings throughout the Portland areas. Use these buildings to fix up and add space for people or shelters for the homeless. There is no quick solution to the housing crisis, but making it affordable and accessible to all is a start.
The problems facing Portland housing today are complicated, but not incurable. Portland has undergone a massive growth spurt in the past few decades. While this has promoted growth in certain economic sectors, it has also created a huge strain on housing. We can see that this housing crisis has primarily affected lower-income citizens. Families and individuals have been forced out of their homes due to rising rent. Some have become homeless. there are many social programs in place to help the people most affected by these housing problems. However, if any of these programs were the end-all solution we needed, we wouldn't have gotten into this mess in the first place. Based on current trends, the overall problem seems to be getting marginally less dire. The demand is slowly decreasing, while the supply is beginning to catch up. Legislation has been put in place to help mitigate and control some of the worst symptoms of the crisis. The problems we face as a community can inevitably be solved if we all stand together to face them. Keep yourself educated on the current events of your community. Continue to advocate and spread the idea that housing is a right for all people, not just the wealthy. Be mindful and be kind to those less fortunate than you, as we are all fighting through our own housing struggles in our own ways. Together, we can solve anything, including the housing crisis that Portland is facing. Hopefully, we can improve the situation as a whole, so none of us have to resort to more extreme measures just to pay the rent.
Hi, I'm Bryce Shivers.
And I'm Lisa Eversman.
We've come upon some tough times.
Money's running low.
It's kind of a long story. Not my fault. But we figured out a solution. Rent
it out. You can rent out anything.
Extra bedroom? Rent it out.
Have a car? Rent it out. Just like New York City. You can rent out everything. Anything. Anyone.
Isn't that kind of like prostitution?
Not when it's from a cute website.
Not when it's from a cute website.
Welcome to the cool, crisp, clean website of Rent It Out.
Very, very simple.
This new economy is so fun. We've rented everything out.
Got room in your fridge?
Rent it out. What a cool site.
My member name is Bryce.
Why don't you tell me your password?
Are you sure?
No, yeah, go ahead. Here's his password.
Shivers1. Got a couch?
Rent it out.
Rent it
out. Have an extra toothbrush?
Rent it out. No toothpaste, all right.
I'm not a taxi driver. I'm just a girl with a car, so I rent it out. He's a total stranger. I feel completely safe. We're living on a roof now. It's the only space available.
Hey, if you're gonna rent it out, you have to make sure that you sign the sheet down.
Rent it?
He's supposed to say out. So, out.
No, don't walk out. Today I'm cleaning someone else's kitchen.
How did you end up in that situation?
I said that I could mop and some lady chose me.
Wow.
There's no one less skilled at this than me.
Yeah, but you're the one who signed up to do it.
These people, they're basically just hiring like art students to come and like watch their kids and like mop their floors.
Those kids. Thank you.